add it on your calendar. Next week is Mother's Day. It's an exciting day. It'll be an exciting day here. We've got the bell choir, and we're having the adult bells and our intermediate Wesley bells, and we're having our children's cherub bells play together, all of them together. So there will be a lot of beautiful ringing coming. But it's Mother's Day. And before you get here to church, you might want to send your mom a card, or maybe you want to buy her some flowers. And of course, that's what we're talking about today. So I did some research, flower research, and I found out that there are some really special flowers. If you really want to wow your mother, here's what you should buy: the saffron crocus. The saffron crocus is one of the most expensive, extravagant flowers in the world. It sells for a mere $1,500 a pound. Don't you want to get some saffron crocus seed and start planting that in your backyard? Maybe. You'd perhaps prefer the gold of Kinabalu orchid. I don't think I'm even saying that right. But the gold of Kinabalu orchid, one single stem, one stick of this flower sells for $5,000 on the black market. It's so rare, so hard to get. It takes $5,000 to get this beautiful orchid. Now, perhaps you're thinking those things, yeah, they seem nice, but they're not quite extravagant enough for you. Perhaps you would like the Juliet rose. This Juliet rose was sold once in 2006, a very rare bloom. It was sold for $15.8 million for a rose. Now, maybe all of this, I admit, it's a bit extravagant. So perhaps you want just the simple tulip. But even the humble tulip, a tulip in the 17th century, if you thought you wanted to get mom a tulip for Mother's Day, it cost, in the 17th century, 1637, there was something called tulip mania happening in Holland. And a single tulip bulb cost up to 10 times a skilled craftsman's annual salary. 10 times their annual salary. People were shelling out money to buy tulip bulbs. Now, I know that seems a little ridiculous, but my mom was just telling me she lives just south of Holland, Michigan. And even those frugal, wonderful Dutch folk in Holland, Michigan shelled out extra money this year, this fall. They bought 410,000 bulbs from the Netherlands just for their tulip festival that's happening this weekend. So we go a little crazy for flowers. That's what I learned in all of my research, that some people sometimes go a little bit crazy for flowers. And why not? They're lovely and they're beautiful. And maybe you're not of the flower type. My husband doesn't even know, and I'm sorry to admit this on camera here, but he doesn't know the difference between a tulip or a rose. He walks right by them and barely notices that there's a flash of color there. So maybe you're not in that number of noticing the flowers, but there they are. And some people find them so beautiful, they're willing to pay millions, they're willing to do whatever they can to get their hands on them. And it is important to appreciate beauty in the world. And so as we dive into our story today, we see how Simon the magician did notice beauty in the Holy Spirit. He noticed beauty that these apostles had something that he just couldn't quite get his hands on. They knew something was going on, and he was impressed and wanted a hold of that. In Acts chapter 8, verse 9, it tells us that Simon was quite famous and well known. He was, as we've been saying, a magician, but he was not, I don't think, like the Penn and Teller or Harry Houdini kind of magician. He was putting on shows, perhaps, but it was more like, you might think, miracles that come from an impressive medical facility, like going to the Mayo Clinic, or you watch those commercials about the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, and they promise, like, oh, we have this amazing amazing team of doctors, and instantly, if you come here, you will be healed. And I know it doesn't work that way, and I know that's not really what they're promising, but sometimes, don't you watch those commercials and think they're promising magic? And so Simon the magician was sort of like that. In the first century, people went to magicians in order to be healed, in order to find a job, in order to have things go better. And so Simon the magician was so impressive that people said he had the power of God. They called him great. So he had showmanship, but they were more impressed with his power. His power was like getting bulbs to bloom, and he was so impressive, and they looked at the power that he had, and they said, I want that, and they were willing to pay whatever it took to get that power that Simon had. So this is the world that he lives in, a world of economy, a world of power, a world of showing off his skills, and along comes Philip the evangelist, if you will, to meet Simon the magician. And Philip begins to tell about the kingdom of God, and he tells about Jesus and Jesus' life and his death and his resurrection, and everyone is impressed. They love hearing these stories of Jesus, and even Simon says that he wants to become a Christian and believes these words of Philip. And it's caused such a big stir. There's so many people wanting this power that Philip is talking about, that Peter and John come in from Jerusalem and they begin to baptize people. And as they do, the Holy Spirit comes just as it did at Pentecost with power and might, and people are being healed and lives are being changed, and it's amazing. And so Simon sees this and he knows that there's something incredible going on here. Now, before we get to the bad part where Simon gets in trouble, let's pause for a moment here and talk about how powerful and beautiful the Holy Spirit is. The Holy Spirit, like a precious flower, is incredible and worth paying millions just to get your hands on it. The Holy Spirit makes God's presence known to us today, and we should not only want to receive this power, but share it also with others. Simon, in some ways, had exactly the right ideas that this was something incredible and something that he should want to pass on to others. But then Simon took it a step too far. You see, he asked Peter and John if he could buy this power of the Holy Spirit, if he could somehow control and be able to pay for the power of laying hands on other people. He was a magician. He was used to bartering in this economy of showmanship. He knew that you could pay for tricks. You could pay for showmanship. You could pay for skills to pass on to others. And so he begs Peter and John to let him in on their secret. But the secret is that their power didn't come from them. Their power wasn't a trick. Their power wasn't something that they could bottle and box and sell. Their power came directly from God, and it was something that was beyond their control. It wasn't something that they could sell, something that they had a handle on and could give to Simon. The Spirit is not submissive to the human race. Instead, we are taught that we need to be submissive to God. The minute that we try to control and manipulate and box in beauty, the less beautiful it becomes. You see, the problem with paying millions for a flower is that 2 or 3 weeks later, that flower is gone. Even if you press it in a book between wax paper, that there's a certain kind of beauty in a pressed flower. But it's only a certain kind of beauty, isn't it? It's not the flower itself, as beautiful as it is when the dew falls on it in the morning sunlight. It's not quite the same when you press it in a book. Flowers fade. A cut flower lasts a very short time in water. You can give it that stuff that they give you at the floral shop and put it in and mix it up. And it lasts a little longer than it does in regular water, but not much. You can leave it growing in the native soil, but even then, after a while, all the petals fall off the tulip. The violets turn into growing plants. The apple blossoms eventually start producing apples. Those beautiful flowers that we admire so much, they fade away. We can't control them. We can't keep them forever. A flower is not meant to last for years and years. It's meant to serve its purpose and help us to produce the fruit of the plant. Flowers are the goal of any plant, or flowers are not the goal of the plant. The plant produces the flower in order to attract the pollinators so that the pollen can come and that the fruit can be formed. The flowers are not the goal. On their own, they're beautiful, but their beauty serves a greater purpose. And the same is true of the Holy Spirit. It's beautiful, but the Holy Spirit is only one part of the Trinity. It's meant to draw us deeper into connection and relationship with God the Father and God the Son. And the minute that we try to control and manipulate God, the less beautiful that church things and the less beautiful that our faith becomes. God is not one that we can exploit for our own purposes. And as I wrote that sentence, I thought about that movie with Steve Martin, where he is an evangelist and he goes out and he tries to con all of these communities into believing in his miracles. And I thought about other evangelists, many that you can probably know and fill in the blank, real people, that took in huge crowds and convinced them that they had this power to make people walk. And then later we found out that they were lining their own pockets. You see, you can't control the Holy Spirit. The minute you try to control and manipulate beauty, the more it becomes a withered, rotting flower. And unfortunately, we can't just blame those evil outsiders that take our faith and twist it. We too have some element of trying to control God for our own benefit. We seek God's comfort without being willing to take time to look and listen to God in the scriptures. We take and seek God's guidance without being willing to receive correction. We long for love and connection from God, but we're not always willing to be vulnerable enough to receive that love and that intimacy from others. We want the flowers without understanding the deeper lessons that God has for us. The gifts of the Holy Spirit are a part of God, and they're beautiful and lovely and to be greatly desired. But these gifts are not to be used on their own or to be exploited for their own power. Instead, they're to be a pointer back to our Lord and our Savior, our God and our Father. And so we're left with this question this morning to wrestle with and ponder with: how do we appreciate the beauty of God's good gifts without manipulating and controlling and exploiting it? And I think the answer to this comes in the fact that, again, the goal of a flower is not the beauty of the petal itself, but the goal of a plant, the goal of a flower, is to help produce fruit. A flower is there to attract the pollinators and help that fruit to form. And the goal of the Holy Spirit is to produce faithful disciples. Any goal that stops short of this is one that needs to be very carefully examined. And so we must ask ourselves as we do ministry together, where is the fruit? What is this flower, so to speak, producing? Is it leading us to discipleship, or is it leading us down a path that we don't want, the crazy path of spending millions on a single bloom? So often in the church, we do get stuck on flowers instead of fruit. We admire the beauty of our sanctuary, and sometimes we just stop there and think, what a pretty place this is. We love the beautiful aroma of the coffee and the bagels downstairs, and sometimes we get stuck there, getting upset if we don't get the cinnamon crunch bagel, which is obviously the best, upset if we don't get the French vanilla coffee. We get stuck on just the flower part of it. We get stuck in the secluded beauty of our private garden and our close friends, and we forget about the fruit of discipleship. Now, a beautiful sanctuary isn't a sinful thing. unless you only focus on the beauty. But if this beauty draws your eyes upward and to the heavens and reminds you that God is here, then the sanctuary has done its job. The coffee and the bagels, they are important on their own, but if they draw you into conversation and you begin to share what's really going on in your world, then they've done their job. If they allow us to be more hospitable and welcoming to the newcomer, then they have done their job well. The coffee and the bagels are a vehicle to deeper discipleship. And those private gardens, they're important. We need private beauty and quiet time. We need time secluded with a small group, a garden party, if you will. But if those lessons that we learn in those private spaces don't spill over into the rest of our lives, then they haven't really done their job. The flowers help us get to the fruit. Simon got carried away with his focus on the power and the miracles, and he missed what God was doing. And sometimes we miss that too. Today, later today, we'll be celebrating baptism and confirmation. And today in this service, we'll be celebrating the Holy Communion together. And these are important acts, important signposts in our faith that tell us that God is here and God is with us. But on their own, they don't mean much. This is just a horse trough. This is just water. It's regular water. This is bread and it's grape juice. But when we come together, when we are in worship, when we are gathered together and invite the Holy Spirit to be present among us, they become so much more. This becomes a tank that gives way to our faith and marks the birth of our journey with God. This table becomes the place where we remember that Christ gave his life for us and is risen and is with us and wants to live in us so that we might be for the world the body and blood of Christ. These elements are flowers, but they draw us deeper into the Spirit and bring us ever closer to the presence of our loving triune God. The psalmist said, "The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our Lord lasts forever."